Hi everyone and welcome back to our channel. Now today's video is going to be on a topic that I find to be super interesting. Now I have been interested in this for the longest time. I don't know why, but stories of this nature have fascinated me ever since I was a child. And because of this fascination, we're actually going to turn this into a series. So today we're going to be talking about a crazy survival story. And we're also going to be making that a series on our channel. Now, we're not going to just talk about survivors of the true crime nature. We're also going to talk about people that have survived the impossible, the unthinkable, the unimaginable, situations that you would never assume that anyone would be able to survive. But by some miracle, they do, and they live to tell the craziest stories. Now, in today's video, we're going to talk about one of these survivors, and I haven't seen too many people cover this story. But before we get into today's crazy story, I just want to send a quick reminder to please consider subscribing and sharing or hitting the like button. It really does help us grow here on YouTube. Now today's video is about a man called Mauro Prosperi, and he actually survived getting lost in the middle of the Sahara Desert for 10 days on his own. So to give you a little bit of background on Mauro, he was born in Rome in 1955. In all his life, he considered himself to be a fairly active person to the point where his full-time job was eventually a police officer. And during his spare time, he was actually an Olympic pentathlete. Now, this story takes place in 1994. So at that time, he was still fairly young. He was still in shape. He was definitely active and consistently training for these sorts of sporting events and activities. Mauro was the type of guy that was constantly looking for the next challenge and would rarely say no to these ones, especially if they were ones that would push him. And one day, his friend, who actually ended up running the race with him, ended up telling him about a ultra marathon that Mauro had never heard about at the time. So his friend tells him that this marathon takes place in Morocco and it's in the middle of the Sahara Desert. And right away, Mauro is like, yes, yes, we need to do this. So they sign up for the race and start training. Now, to give you a little bit of background on what the race is, the race has been going on for quite a bit. And when it started fairly small, like all things. It's not like what it is today, where there's over 1,000 racers that compete in it. The official name of the race is Marathon des Sables, which actually translates in French, it means the sand marathon. You can walk the race, you can run the race, you can go at your own pace, there's really no pressure. It spans 250 kilometers and on average usually takes about 7 days to complete. Now the thing about this race is that because it does take several days to complete, racers are told and they are expected to run with their backpacks that are meant to have their sleeping supplies, their cooking supplies, all their food, basically anything they would need to survive out in the wilderness for 7 days. The only thing that actually gets replenished for them is their water supply at every checkpoint as they make their way through the race. So as you can imagine, running a race of this length in the middle of the desert under extreme heat takes quite a big toll on anyone's body. So Mauro was very, very dedicated to his training. He wanted to do his best. He wanted to show himself that he could do this. So his training was very, very hardcore. He would run approximately 40 kilometers a day, and he would actually train his body to need less and less water every day just to get his body used to dehydrated conditions so he would be able to make it through the longer legs of the race without struggling as much as anyone else would. So the race takes place on April 10th, 1994. And at the race is Mauro, his friend Giovanni, the one that told him about the race, and 80 other racers. First 3 days of the race went smoothly according to Mauro. He was running alongside Giovanni the entire time. They were able to cover approximately 60 miles or 96 kilometers as they were passing through long stretches of the desert. So on the fourth day, Mauro and Giovanni ended up separating. And it wasn't because they got into a fight or anything. It was just the natural progression of the race. Giovanni started falling behind. He wasn't able to keep up with Mauro anymore. So Mauro took the lead. He started running further ahead of Giovanni. And because of the nature of the race, and because there was also only 80 racers at that time, like I mentioned earlier, the race today hosts over 1,300 people. So it's a lot harder to separate or get lost from people when there's that many people in the race. But at this time, because there was only 80 people in the race, Mauro was so far ahead of most of the people that it got to the point where he was basically running on his own. And at this point, Mauro had actually reached fourth place. So he thought he was making really good pace. He was really, really excited. It was his goal, obviously, to come in first. So being in fourth place to him was really good. So on the fourth day, as Mauro's running, the weather conditions really just went from being perfect to literally the absolute worst. A sandstorm started to form in the middle of the desert where Mauro was. And initially, Mauro was kind of freaking out. He was a little bit worried. So instead of stopping, Mauro actually picked up the pace, hoping or thinking that he would probably be able to outrun the sandstorm. But unfortunately, it was just too intense, too powerful, and he definitely had no chance of outrunning it. He started to worry that if he were to stop and wait out the sandstorm, that the sand would actually pile up and would end up burying him, like burying him alive. So he definitely did not want that to happen. I mean, I don't think anyone would. So he decided to keep running. He didn't think that he was going to outrun the storm, but he figured that if he could keep moving, he would be fine. What he didn't realize is that he was actually running in the very wrong direction. He had completely gone off the trail by accident. When I look back on interviews or articles about him talking about what happened, in his mind, he was convinced that he was still on the path. He was still on the race trail because he thought he had seen clues pointing to him that he was okay. He was still going in the right direction, but he was wrong. He had actually ran 8 hours in the wrong direction. So when the storm finally stopped, that's when he realized how bad a lot of his injuries were. He described the storm having a sensation of needles just slamming across his face. And when he was able to look at himself in a reflective surface, he was able to see that his face was all cut up from the sand, basically hitting his face at really, really high speeds. His nose was bleeding and he was struggling to breathe because as much as he tried, a lot of the sand did go into his mouth and into his nose, which is why his nose was bleeding. But he was also struggling to breathe because he did swallow a fair amount of sand. So not wanting to make his injuries any worse, he realized that he needed to rest and kind of recover. So he decided to stop for the day. He found a nearby bush and decided to just set up camp there, sleep the night, and then start fresh the next day. So day two comes around, he wakes up super early and he figures that he will run into the other racers along the way. He wasn't too worried. He still felt like he was on the right track. It wasn't until he had ran for approximately 4 hours that he realized that there was something wrong. He hadn't come across any other racers and he had realized that he had actually lost sight of the trail. So he decides to climb onto one of the really, really tall sand dunes nearby. So he climbs all the way to the top, and when he gets there, he does a 360, takes a look to see if he can see anyone or anything that might point him in the right direction, but he saw absolutely nothing. There was just sand and sand in every single direction. That's when he realized that the sandstorm had completely disoriented him, and he had lost track of all clues. He had absolutely no idea where he was. Now, this is where he went into survival mode. Automatically, he started planning on how to ration his food. He started looking to see how much water he had left. And unfortunately, he said that he only had less than half a bottle of water. And this is when he remembered a story his grandfather had once told him, that you could actually survive off of drinking your own urine. So Mauro took his spare water bottle, one that was empty, and started saving his own urine just in case he had to kind of resort to it, because he had no idea how long he would be out there for. The next thing he did is what we're all told to do when we get lost. When we get lost, we're all told to stay in place and to wait, and that eventually someone will realize that you're lost and they will come looking for you. So he waited and waited all day, but no one came. That was until he heard a helicopter in the distance. So he figures that this helicopter must be looking for him. So he gets super excited and he starts screaming. He starts jumping and wailing and waving his hands, trying everything he can to get the attention of this helicopter. Even fires a small flare gun that they had given him at the race in case something like this did happen. Unfortunately, the helicopter did not see him. They definitely couldn't hear him. They didn't see him. And Mauro was so disappointed because he remembers that the helicopter had gotten so close that he was able to see what the pilot was wearing. So the helicopter just flies right above him, right past him, leaving Mauro completely shocked and no idea what to do next. So he stays there the night, and the next day he decides enough. He's been there all day. There's no signs of anyone actually coming for him or anyone that might actually see him. And he's also been out in the sun for most of the day. So he doesn't want to get heat stroke. He doesn't want to get really severe sunburns. So he decides that his only option in this situation is to now keep moving and to look for some shade. Starts walking and walking and walking, and all he really sees in any direction is sand. He's trying to figure out where he is. He does have a map with him. He has a small compass, but without any clear distinction or landmarks to kind of show him where he is on the map, he has absolutely no idea where to go. He's just walking and hoping that he'll find something or someone, and to his luck, he actually does. He actually comes across a marabout, which is a Muslim shrine. And these are used by the Bedouins when they're crossing the Sahara Desert. They're used as kind of like pit stops where they can take shelter. There's usually tools and food and water in there. So he figures that there would be someone in there, and if not, there would be something that he could use to his benefit. Walks in, and unfortunately, it's completely abandoned. But he does see some positivity here. He did find something that he could use for shelter. So he starts unpacking himself and making himself a little bit more comfortable as he starts thinking about what to do next. So as he's unpacking his bag, he starts sorting through the different things that he has in there. And that's when he sees and he remembers that he actually has a large Italian flag. So he realizes that he should probably climb to the top of the shrine and pin it or place it somehow on the roof so any planes or helicopters that are flying by would be able to see this. So he starts climbing, he gets to the top, he pins the flag, and as he's coming back down, that's when he notices a bat colony that was hidden at the top in one of the corners of the shrine. And this is when he decides that he basically has no choice. This is the only food source around him. He basically decides that he has to eat bats to survive. He ends up drinking their blood. He ends up eating all of their insides raw. He also ended up scavenging on bird eggs, small little reptiles that he was able to find, and beetles as well. Now, on the fourth day he was missing, he had an idea. He decided that since there were planes in the area that he saw the previous day, he decided to carve out a huge SOS sign in the sand. So he had a stick and he starts carving and he's finishing that up. And then he realizes that he has some extra materials in his backpack that he hasn't used yet. He realizes that he can make a fire with these things. So he makes a decent sized fire next to the SOS sign. So he could at least get some heavy smoke signals up in the air. As soon as the fire really gets going, a huge, huge sandstorm starts forming again and completely wipes out all the work he had put in that entire day and the day before. Unfortunately, the sandstorm ended up lasting 12 hours, so he had nothing to do. Like, there was nothing he could do. He basically had to go inside the shrine and wait it out. After the sandstorm, Mauro was really, really depressed. He did not know what he was gonna do. He had really lost a lot of hope, and when I was looking into the story, that this is when he had basically hit his lowest. He had no way of knowing whether or not people were looking for him. He didn't know whether he was going to survive or not. All he could think about was what his wife must have been thinking. At this point, he basically realizes that he's probably better off ending his own life than continuing on like this for who knows how many more days. He finds a pocket knife in his backpack and decides to cut his wrists and lie down and kind of just wait it out, wait for life to take its course and fall asleep. The next morning, so this is now day 5 that he's been missing, and to his surprise, he wakes up. And the reason he didn't actually end up dying is because the cuts that he had done were actually too superficial. They weren't deep enough. And because his body was so dehydrated and it was so hot outside, the blood had actually clotted where the cuts were, which essentially saved his life. So taking this as basically a miracle and taking this as a sign that his life was not ready to be over, it really did give him like an extra boost of confidence and an extra will and drive to survive. So with his renewed will to live, he sets out to walk again into the desert, and this time he strategizes a little bit more. He decides to only walk when it wasn't so hot. So this usually meant the early mornings and the early evenings as well after the sun had set. And during the day, he would find places with shadows like under a bush, in caves, under rocks, basically anywhere he could find shade to hide during the day. And then at night, when it got really, really cold, which it does in the desert, he would actually dig fairly deep holes in the sand where he would go in, he would hide, and then he would cover himself with all the sand to kind of mimic a blanket, which would keep him warm all night. And when it came to food and water, he would actually squeeze, he would find random weeds or plants across the desert, and he would pull them out by the root, and he would squeeze the roots, which would actually give him some drops of water. And for food, he would still continue to scavenge on beetles and whatever reptiles he was able to find along the way. So after 3 days of doing this, he ends up on day 8. And this is when he finally gets some good news. He actually ends up coming across a small oasis that had a small puddle pool of water. So obviously, elated, he runs towards the puddle and starts like forcing the water into his mouth so fast he could barely have time to swallow. But because he was so dehydrated, his throat had actually almost closed up all the way to the point where he couldn't digest the water easily. So he just ended up throwing up all of the water. And this ended up kind of forcing him to take small sips of water throughout the entire day. He kind of just laid down beside the pond or the puddle and just sipped on water all day, slowly and slowly rehydrating himself. So he spends the night there, and on day 9 in the morning, he refills his water bottles and sets out to walk again. And this time, not too long after, he actually comes across goat droppings. He follows these droppings, and then eventually they turn into human footprints. So he continues following the footprints, and eventually he finds a very young shepherd girl tending to her little herd of goats. So obviously, he's so excited. He's like ecstatic to have finally found someone for the first time in 9 days. So he runs towards the girl. He's almost like screaming at her, which he doesn't realize completely terrifies the girl because she's so young. She screams and she runs away over the dunes and kind of just disappears. So that's when he realizes that his condition must be a lot worse than what he thinks. So he pulls out a small mirror that he had in his backpack, and that's when he looks at himself for the first time throughout his entire expedition. And that's when he realizes how bad his condition was. He was practically emaciated. I think he lost approximately like 30-35 pounds of water weight. And he said that his face was so sunken in that his eye sockets had gone so far back that he almost looked like he was a walking skeleton. Fortunately, the little girl does come back, but this time she comes back with her grandmother. Together, they help Mauro and they take him to a nearby Berber tent. This is where they fed him, they gave him some water, some tea, and they took him by camel to the nearest village. So once they got to the village, the police actually thought that he could have been a Moroccan spy. So before they took him to the hospital, they actually blindfolded him so they couldn't see the entire way from the village to the hospital. When he got to the hospital, that's where he was properly identified by the police, so they realized that he was not a Moroccan spy. That's also where they told him what happened and where he was. Mauro had actually traveled 180 miles or 280 kilometers in the wrong direction. And he had gone so far off the course of the race that was supposed to be in Morocco that he unknowingly actually crossed the border into Algeria. So that's why the police in Algeria thought that he could have been a Moroccan spy. So I'll put a map here so you guys can see how far the distance was that he traveled. It's by no means a short feat. The race starts in Foum, Zougid, and was supposed to end in Zagora, Morocco. But as you can see here, he went all the way to Tindouf, Algeria. So he stays in the hospital in Algeria for 7 days as he's recovering, and that's where they actually informed his family that he was still alive. What he didn't know is that his brother and his brother-in-law had been notified, and they were living in Rome at the time. So they had together flown to Morocco to help the search party look for Mauro. But what he didn't know is that they were actually not too far behind him. They were able to follow the traces that he had left behind, and they did come across the shrine where he had taken shelter for those 2 days. And if he had stayed there for a little bit longer, he would have likely been found. After those 7 days in Algeria, he was flown back to Rome, where he had a very, very long road to recovery. And that's where they kind of realized how bad the damage was to his body. On top of losing over 30 pounds, his liver was so badly damaged, it was actually reported as being permanently damaged to a certain extent. But in the initial phase, his liver was so bad that he couldn't eat solid food. He had to live off of a liquid diet for almost 4 whole months. And after going through that intense ordeal, he still had to go through another 2 years of recovery to get back to where he was. But like most survivors that I read about or that I hear about, he didn't let this experience deter him. He was actually very, very determined to come back to the race that almost took his life because he wanted to complete it. He actually came back 6 more times to the same race, and in 2001, so 7 years after this whole thing took place, he came back and actually placed 13th. And that is the story of Mauro Prosperi. It was definitely a very, very crazy story. A very, very intense story for sure. I couldn't imagine being stuck out in the middle of the desert under all that heat for so long. He definitely was determined to live, and I'm very glad he found the will to live. I'm sure his family and his friends were as well. I would be interested to know what you guys would do in a situation like this. What do you think you would do if you got lost in the middle of the desert? Leave your comments down below, I would love to read them. Or if you guys have any other story suggestions about crazy survival stories that you've heard, I would love to read those as well. I'm always on the lookout for the craziest stories. So leave a comment below. That does it for today's video, and I will see you guys in the next one.